Introducing Aron Ra. Aron Ra is a secular activist and advocate for reason in education. He is the former Texas State Director of the American Atheists and currently serves as the president of the Atheist Alliance of America. He hosts the Ra Man podcast with Dan Errol and Mark Nabo of Be Secular, and has a blog on patriots called Reason Advocates, which he shares with his wife, Yolandra. Started in August of 2006, his YouTube channel currently has over 140,000 subscribers and over 21 million views. And now, based on his famous video series, Foundational Falsehoods of Creationism, he has published a book with the same name, and he is here to tell us all about it. Please welcome Aron Ra.
This is a really nice facility that you guys have, your own, you know, little theater. This is nice. I've been to a number of different groups, and most of them, of course, have to rent other venues when they want to have meetings. Even places that, like Houston, for example, they have the largest geographic humanist and atheist groups, and yet they still have to rent out the local venues. They don't have a building of their own, so this is really great that you managed to get this. So the Foundational Falsehoods of Creationism began sort of as a challenge when somebody was getting upset with me because I was wearing a Darwin Fish t-shirt. And she says, you know, you can't prove evolutionism. And I said, well, just the fact that you call it that, you know, kind of betrays the problem here. But yes, I can. And she goes, well, you can't prove evolution, because to prove that, you'd have to prove there is no God. And I told her, well, whether God exists or not is irrelevant. And she sort of staggered backwards. I'm able to deal with that. But, you know, that is the fact of it, because whether there is a God or not, and this is really the first foundational falsehood of creationism right here, whether there is a God or not, you know, that evolution is still a demonstrable fact, an inescapable fact of population genetics. And whether there is a God or not, the Bible is still man-made mythology with no truth in it. So what I discovered was, when I got online, and I had one of those careers where you had unlimited browsing, unrestricted browsing, and unlimited overtime at the same time. So for a half a dozen years or so, I'm just constantly on a learning curve where all I'm doing is ingesting scientific journals and different scriptures of different religions, you know, comparative mythologies and so forth. And that's like literally all I did for a half a dozen years or so. And I started getting into places like alt.talk.creationism and talk.origins back in the days of Usenet. And I found myself arguing with some of the best, you know, the best minds on both sides of this argument. And very quickly I figured out that the minds really are only one side of the argument. The beautiful thing was, I could throw out my question and I would watch these experts on both sides, you know, tear into it, and they're both able to see the answers that they're giving, so I can weigh out, you know, weigh out the options. And then, of course, they also make references about what I should read. And I took the references on both sides about what I should read, and I did. And I noticed that I kept seeing the same arguments again and again and again, right? You know, there's no transitional species, there's no beneficial mutations. What, really? Again? So instead of even writing my own original answer for the upteenth time, I'm just cutting and pasting the answers I wrote before, and then realizing that the answer to the person that I explained this to before was you. What the hell? Do you not learn? All right, so rather than, I wanted to say this also. What I did with the video series was, back then, you only had 10 minutes in order to pack all this information in. And so I knew that, you know, people will go to, go door to door to share their religion. And you go to church on Wednesdays, you go to church on Sundays, and all these other functions. And you don't have to pay for this, and you don't have to understand anything in order to believe, right, the way they're telling you to. Any child can be fooled into believing this. But in order to understand the evolutionary perspective, you have to have a certain amount of aptitude and a great deal of investment of your own time and money and effort and a very specific education. So what I did was, I tailored these videos to people that didn't have that education and maybe didn't have much of an attention span either. And it'll just get the very specific information that they need to address for this argument, with it, you know, stripped away from all the rest of the periphery. Then somebody came up to me, a publisher came up to me and said, you know, you ran through all this information so very fast, started to squeeze everything into a 10-minute frame. You make me flash up all these images, we don't really know what you're talking about. Can you write this as a book and explain, go into depth, and explain the detail about this, which is, of course, what this is. So I did exactly that. And rather than go through and tell you everything that's in the book, because there is more in the book than there is in the video series, but rather than go through and tell you that, I'm going to give you a summary of what the foundational falsehoods are, and note also that in many cases they're also logical fallacies. As a matter of fact, in all of them, there are at least one logical fallacy. So the first foundational falsehood, as I said, is the belief that you either have to accept the Bible verbatim, exactly what it says, or if you're going to accept evolution, then you have to reject God. But there's no other way. There's no alternative religions. There's no theistic evolution. There's no more advanced perspective. You have to take like Ray Comfort's version of creationism, and everybody else is atheist, including Muslims. And I've actually heard Christians say this, that even the Muslims would be considered atheists by their understanding. This is a false dichotomy, of course, and one of the reasons for that is that many of the pioneers of evolutionary biology have been, and some of them still are, they're Christian believers. Some of them have traditional Christian beliefs. As a matter of fact, there was a clergy letter project that followed on the heels of Project Steve and a few other statements like some 800 scientists signed a document published to the Texas Board of Education explaining that evolution is a fact. You know, and there's no doubt that this happened, and it's ridiculous to treat it as if this was a guess or that we're uncertain, right? Well, there's 13,000 somewhat clergy from various different faiths, not just Christianity, that signed this document also saying that evolution is a fact and it's a truth and should be taught as such. So a lot of these people will hold that that you can have a spiritual belief and you can accept evolution, you just don't have to be so very dogmatic about it. The nice thing was, when I was a kid, everybody seemed to have this neutral perspective where it seemed like everybody had a belief in the spirit of some sort, some supernatural nonsense that everybody seemed to hold to, but everybody also understood that you had to accept science because it's a thing, it's real, it's demonstrable, and so forth, and it would be ridiculous to reject that. But what I've seen recently is that the population of the United States has split, largely, where we have a lot of people that are walking away from religion in droves, you know, in general, just entirely. And that's fine, I'm completely down with that, but you also have people that are separating where they are walking away from science entirely. And so while religion is in a general state of decline across the country, somehow, simultaneously, creationism, a form of religious extremism, is on the rise. And the only way that can be is if there's a polarization of the entire nation, and it's going pretty much right down the middle, 46% to 53% or so. So we're having a very divided population. Now, the second foundational falsehood of creationism is the notion that sacred scriptures are the word of God, even though the Bible, for example, credits human authors for each of its books. They're commonly interpreted as though God somehow wrote it. So it's not Paul that wrote this, or it's not, you know, Mark, Luke, Matthew, John. We know these people didn't actually write those books, but we know God didn't write them either. There are passages in there, for example, and I go through the list in here, where there are references to books that have been removed from the New Testament, several other books that have been removed from the Old Testament. So who wrote those? And if they were removed, then why would God write a book that refers to the works of some humans, right? I mean, he would have done everything. He certainly wouldn't know, you should read what that guy said, because he did it, but no, God's not going to do that. So why would God's word refer to the works of some human, especially when the books that they're referring to have been removed from the Bible, even though that's not supposed to be possible, especially if not if God wrote it, right? But then it's also removed, and God's making this reference to it, and you can't read it anymore. They don't exist. So the Bible somehow doesn't account for the fact that this is completely lost information. And there's a lot of interestingly lost information about the Bible. If you look at it, I think it was Justin Martyr that wrote in the second century, he's talking about how, you know, what we propound of Jesus is essentially no different than what you esteem for the sons of Jupiter, right? And he starts talking about things like Jesus, the stories of Jesus being strong like Hercules to run his race. Where the hell was that gospel at? We didn't read that. The superhuman strength of Jesus Christ? Really? So anyway, obviously God wasn't the one that was writing all of this. And I've even heard the argument, special pleading, that the Bible would be a load of crap were it not for the fact that it was written by God. I'm not kidding. And the only thing that keeps it from being a load of crap is the fact that God wrote it. It's just like when people say that Jesus either is who he says he was, or he was a raving lunatic. At least they're open to the more probable possibility. So, this is also a number of other fallacies, from false attribution to argument from authority and the fallacy of moral high ground. My wife showed me a list of logical fallacies, and we just started talking about all the different. Do you recognize this one? Where have you heard this before? You know, so we started. There's this online list of logical fallacies. Start picking out all the religious arguments that we heard that were based on each of these. So the third foundational falsehood of creationism is the idea that human interpretation of Scripture should be considered absolute truth. And this results from the most common of the logical fallacies that are used by creationists. This is circular reasoning. Begging the question with an assumed conclusion. The belief that the story is true because the story says it's true. And all of the apologetics that I hear are the circular argument rounding back to an assumed conclusion. Unable to question that. The fourth foundational falsehood of creationism is the idea that belief equals knowledge. This is essentially what Gnosticism was all about. There's some argument about what Gnostic means versus what agnostic means, and I have some criticisms of Thomas Huxley for inventing the word agnostic, not paying attention to what the word Gnostic meant, so that you can't have, you can have an agnostic atheist. Most atheists are agnostic. But when you're not uncertain about whether God exists, like I'm not uncertain. You know, I'm fairly confident there's no damn God. This is not a requirement to be an atheist, to be sure. I mean, as long as you don't have theism, you can be an apatheist. You cannot care if there's a God. You're still atheist, right? But, and I just tied myself up and lost where I was going. Okay, but Gnosticism was the assertion that belief equals knowledge. If you feel it, or you know it in your heart, right? Nobody knows shit in their heart, right? Knowledge is demonstrable, right? It's testable with measurable accuracy. And so this is the argument that I have with believers all the time, that is one of the most irritating for me. You know, I actually heard a minister say, I know that 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 I know there's a God. He doesn't know shit. So this is also the fallacy of presupposition, and the fourth chapter also talks about presuppositionalism, and it brings up one of the most dreaded names in that whole practice, which will not be uttered here. But begins with Psy and ends with Bergen Cave. But anyway, there's a lot of talk about the fallacies that are involved with that, which is, you know, presupposition is a fallacy. So the fifth foundational falsehood of creationism also involves a little bit of history, because it talks about how people make the assertion that America was founded as a Christian nation. So this chapter is the first one to delve a little bit into the history that to rebut that claim. But the fallacy itself, or the foundational falsehood, is that evolution is a religion, just like creationism is. And this is the fallacy of false equivalence, which is another really common one. So it's an attempt to, this is also the two-quoque fallacy, but it's an attempt to sling mud onto your opponent so that nobody notices how much mud is on you. This is kind of like when a child tries to minimize the punishment by sharing the blame. You know, she did it too! Except that, you know, and then this people would call the pot calling the kettle black, but in this case, in the analogy, this is a child blaming a completely innocent person. So it's the pot calling the silverware black. Yeah. The sixth foundational falsehood of creationism is a continuation on the evolutionism idea. This is where evolution has to replace God in everything that they used to attribute to God. So that evolution is no longer just a theory of biodiversity. It somehow has to account for the origin of life, the universe, and everything. So whenever anybody wants to argue about evolution, the first thing they start doing is, you can't prove how life, you know, create life out of nothing. The fuck are you? That's not even what evolution is. And so there's an awful lot of discussion just based on that. But of course, I talk about abiogenesis, and I talk about Big Bang cosmology, and all the other associated sciences explaining what people get wrong there. One of the ones and I haven't brought this up in other meetings, but one of the things that really bothers me about this is, if you look up the dictionary, if you look up abiogenesis, in any common dictionary, you will find it associated with spontaneous generation. Every dictionary, every layman's dictionary I've seen, associates these two words. And they'll say that abiogenesis was disproved by Louis Pasteur 200 years ago, right? No, this is not remotely correct. And I have written to a couple of these dictionaries, Merriam-Webster and dictionary.com, to alert them to what the actual definitions are. and what the science is behind each one, and how one was refuted and the other one was not. But they will not change their definitions, even when they know it's wrong. Similarly, you can't get them to correct the definition of atheist either. They'll still say that an atheist is one who denies there is a God, denies the existence of God, rather than we simply don't buy that bullshit. So the sixth foundational falsehood is also a category error and the fallacy of a single cause and the fallacy of composition and division, where what is applied to one aspect needs to be applied to the rest of it too. The seventh foundational falsehood of creationism is the idea that evolution is random. And I go into some explanation as to how it's really not. If you look at population mechanics, it's actually deterministic. It's an emergent property from the bottom up rather than an authoritarian dictate from the top down. It's an unguided, blind design, but is incidentally deterministic. Of course, what the believers mean when they talk about something being random is it wasn't predetermined for a purpose. And I don't know what their fascination is. You know, I've seen some of the creationist magazines or the Christian magazines where, you know, Purpose-Driven Life is one of their favorite books, and one of their magazines is called Purpose, right? So they want to think that they are the reason that the universe exists, and they want to accuse me of arrogance for saying that I'm not. Of course, this is what they'd rather believe, which is the fallacy of wishful thinking. And that is a natural fallacy. It's also a regression fallacy, ascribing cause where none exists, because people have a tendency to think that everything was intended. We all imagine that there are patterns. And I'm guilty of this myself. It always seems like, you know, people will tell you, oh, things will always work out in the end, and they normally do, you know, and it does seem like the fates have got things set up for me in some way. I've just had one of these charm sorts of life, you know, and I realize that pattern doesn't really exist. Karma was actually the hardest thing for me to let go of all my supernatural beliefs. It was karma. I wanted to believe that if you are positive and you're humanitarian and you're charitable, that, you know, generally you put out all these good energies, you're going to get good energies back. Whereas if you're a shit to people, obviously you're going to get shit back, right? But what I've consistently seen is completely apathetic, horrible people getting everything they want without ever having any idea they've ever done anything wrong. Right? Even when they're caught, even when they're punished, they somehow have some defense mechanism in their mind so that they never admit guilt. Which is, what is the satisfaction of if they've never even understood that they've done something wrong, right? And then you see people that don't deserve, by any means, the horrible things that have happened to them. And, you know, like when children dying of leukemia, my own granddaughter being an example of this, you know, there's just not any chance of karma. And I have several other mentioned. So, as a matter of fact, since he's in the audience, there's a friend of mine that's here tonight that was actually part of one of my escapes from karma. As a matter of fact, this might have been the night that I gave up that belief. This guy comes over with a bunch of our friends, and they have a gun cleaning party, which is really just we're in Texas, you know. And they show up with all the most ridiculous weapons they could find, you know, like a machine gun, a handheld pistol that has 99 9mm rounds, fully auto. Right now, how overkill is that? Another guy shows up with a Derringer, one of the snub-nosed Derringers that shoots 12-gauge. The round is as big as the gun, which is ridiculous. So I'm always going to show up with machine guns and everything like that. Even on top of the machine guns, they're all in the house. And half a dozen guys are all big, scary, nasty people. And we've got medieval weapons hanging on the wall. And we've got two wolf hybrids living with me, too. So it's a very dangerous house at this moment. But everybody leaves. Right? Everybody leaves eventually. And I was still smoking at that time. And I had one cigarette sitting by the window. And it's time for bed. I smoke my cigarette, I let the dogs out, I'm heading upstairs. Dogs go apeshit. And I come back down and let the dogs in because they're going berserk. And I don't want them to disturb the neighbors because our neighbors were already disturbed. It was a bad place. So I let the door in, I open the door and let the dogs in, and I hear a gunshot. Shit, somebody's shooting at my dogs. Or so I think. What had actually happened is, as my friends left, they leave and another car pulls up. I'm sitting there smoking a cigarette. And so I don't notice, and another couple of cars pulled up. And what had happened was that some guy went to go pick up his niece in a bar to take her home to meet the family for Thanksgiving. Now, the guys that were in the bar that were hitting on the girl got mad that she left with somebody else, not them. So they followed him. And they get to my apartment, sitting right outside my window. and they get up to have an argument. Now at this moment, I'm letting the dogs out, so I don't hear the argument until the gunshot. And so what had happened was like minutes, 3 minutes, after there's a half a dozen heavily armed guys with freaking machine guns everywhere and throwing knives and axes and wolves. Right? When once all that's gone, somebody's Thanksgiving holiday is destroyed by senseless violence. And if I'd sat there another minute, myself alone, if I hadn't got up to let the dogs out, myself alone, I would have let the wolves on them. If I'd seen the fight, I would have come out with axes and stuff. You know, but if it had been 5 minutes earlier, there would have been too many guns for a gunfight, if you know what I mean. You know, you're going to pull out your six-shooter, oh, I see, never mind. But, you know, this was a disturbing moment for me. This was one where I had to question, where is the justice in this? If there was a God, if there was any kind of karma, there would have been a moment for heroism, right? And it was denied. So I had to let go of that belief, and I'm sorry for going off on that story. But anyway, the eighth foundational falsehood of creationism is the claim that there have never been any beneficial mutations. And of course, in the book, I go through a list of beneficial mutations from textbooks and from other sources. And this assumes that design, or the fallacy here, assumes that design is intentional, you know, as opposed to incidental. And so any deviation, any alteration, must be a degradation from an originally perfect design. And of course, we have to explain what's all wrong with that. And there's also an associated argument that there can be no way of creating new genetic information. Now, I'd be perfectly happy to tell you that it takes more information to create a bird than it does a dinosaur, but they can't tell you how much information in either case. So how can they tell you which one is more, right? This is also the fallacy of accent or ambiguity. The ninth foundational falsehood of creationism is the assertion that there have never been any transitional species. In my video, I flash pictures of like a few hundred different transitional species with just the names while I'm talking really fast over that. I didn't want to do that in the chapter because written out that could be dry. So I just selected a handful to explain exactly how they are certainly, definitely, undeniably transitional species. The trouble is that creationists cannot admit these because of another logical fallacy called the slippery slope. If you admit that Archaeopteryx is a transitional, or that Acanthostega is a transitional, or any, you know, a myriad other examples, then you're going to have to make other admissions too. So they can't ever do that. And I actually got into a moderated debate with somebody who was courting the Board of Education, who admitted to me in writing, in front of moderators, that he knew that there were transitional species in the fossil record, but he wanted to teach students there were none, because he said it was important that they believe there are none. So he admitted that it's okay to lie, knowingly, to other people's kids in order to manipulate their belief. And this also requires the logical fallacy of out-of-context quotations, which we often see, usually of Darwin, but also of Stephen Jay Gould and, of course, many others. The tenth foundational falsehood of creationism is the assertion that the tree of life is an illusion, possibly of coincidence, but is not actually indicated by anything in biology, which is another thing that's close to my heart because one of the things that my wife and I do, or that we've started, one of the projects that we started once we got onto Patreon, by the way, everything I do is funded by patreon.com/ARONRA. Helpful to throw that out. If you sign up to donate per video, which is what the usual arrangement is, you know, that I make 6 videos a month generally, and that would cost you like $6 a month, I could use all the help I can get. One of the things that we do with this is we do, my wife is a curriculum specialist with the Next Generation Science Data, a former middle school science teacher. She writes the scripts for a classroom supplement science series where we teach biology to middle schooler and high school kids. And these are also being used by some homeschoolers as well. That's one of our projects. And that project is also being endorsed by the Richard Dawkins Foundation under the TIES program, the Teachers Institute for Science Education. One of the other projects we do is the Phylogeny Explorer project, where we are doing a complete rendering of the phylogenetic tree of life as a navigable online encyclopedia, which will be, once it's done, fully illustrated with lots of explanations about the value of the clades. And we're not talking about individual species here. We're talking about what does it mean to be a deuterostome, a coelomate, a hominid, for example, mammals, and so forth. All of these type explanations. And so people will be able to see where one species turns into another, essentially, and instead of the misrepresentation that we're going to get to in the next foundational falsehood of creationism, actually. The one for the 10th is the gambler's fallacy, asserting that similarities between species are just a matter of coincidence, or it's the furtive fallacy, where it's actually contrived according to someone's sinister agenda. The 11th foundational falsehood of creationism is the claim that macroevolution has never been observed, making an arbitrary distinction between micro and macro. And this is a straw man fallacy because they have to change what macroevolution is or what it means. And I have to spend a great deal of time explaining exactly what it really is, despite what they say it is. It's often being misrepresented as the idea that a fish decided to grow legs so that it could go for a walk. Or that you would have something like a half fish, half giraffe. Or it would be cats giving birth to dogs. Or most commonly, it's one thing turning into a completely different thing. So anytime you bring up an example of a new species, a fruit fly or finch or whatever, people say that it's still a bird, or it's still a fish, or you know, it didn't turn into something else. And an activist that I know and admire called Zach Cochran, he was a high schooler in Louisiana when Louisiana passed this law so they teach creationism in their public schools. I don't remember what loophole they found in that to really enable them to do that. But anyway, he went to the state senate and testified giving examples of speciation events that were known to occur and documented. And the senator that was taking the testimony interrupted them and said, okay, well, they're talking about a new species of bacteria. And he said, well, but did the bacteria turn into a person? So this is how bewilderingly inane the creationist mindset is. So, turning into reduced, I think it's reductio ad absurdum. Somebody please explain to me how to pronounce that. The 12th foundational falsehood of creationism is that creationism is somehow scientific. This is another attempt at the fallacy of false equivalence, where they want to take everything, all of the sciences that are allied against them, package them all under the idea of evolutionism, cast all of science as if it were a belief, and then inflate their own perspective as if they're two equal things, or two sides of the same coin, which of course it's not remotely. This is also an ad hoc fallacy because all the claims that were made up in this category are made up out of nothing. The 13th foundational falsehood of creationism is the idea that, or the claim, that evolution is a fraud. And this may be my favorite chapter in the whole book, because we go into a little bit of the history here. And we talk about Nebraska Man and Peltdown Man and Archaeoraptor and a half a dozen other things that creationists want to assert as all part of some concentrated conspiracy of big evolution to fool people into believing in their false religion. Which, you know, some creationists like Kent Hovind, for example, have said that evolution was a fairy tale for grown-ups. An important note is here. If you look at what a fairy tale is, it's a folklore story, generally with a moral, but which has fanciful characters like wizards, witches, giants, dragons, and animals that talk and act like human beings casting magic spells. And of course, this doesn't describe evolution at all, but it's a perfect description of Genesis, isn't it? So Genesis would still be, you know, a fairy tale. You know, my wife says that the fact that it evokes gods makes it more myth, but I still think it classifies under both categories. The 13th FFOC is also a logical fallacy of ad hominem, or at least a failed attempt at such, and an appeal to motive. The 14th FFOC is the claim that creationism, or that there is evidence of divine miraculous creation. And that's not even possible that you could have evidence of that. So what they argue is that anything science can't explain can be explained by magic. And of course, I don't admit that they believe in magic, but the definition of miracle and magic is the same. They are essentially, both of them are the evocation of supernatural forces or energy to control or forecast natural events in ways which are inexplicable by science because they defy the laws of physics, meaning that they are physically impossible, and thus God is physically impossible by definition. This fallacy, is making up explanations out of nothing as well as assuming a conclusion and requires shifting of the burden of proof. The 15th and final foundational falsehood of creationism is the claim that evolution is just a theory, not a fact. And I had to take this topic up with the chairman of the Board of Education in my state, when she was arguing that 150 professional scientists had given testimony saying that the theory of evolution was actually better supported than the theory of gravity. And she got angry that they were calling it a theory of gravity because she insisted that it was a law of gravity. And I wish I could get this woman to actually read the posts that were being used in this debate that she was supposed to be moderating, because we had to put in a number of laws of gravity in the multiple theories of, between the Newtonian gravity and, of course, relativity, and explain what's wrong with the theory of gravity. Why don't we teach the weaknesses of the theory of gravity, right? Why don't we teach what gravity got wrong? We're not gonna float away, right? So they also she wanted to say that that we were creating this illusion that evolution was on equal footing with what she considers laws, as if, and they want to treat the highest level of confidence in scientific study as if it's just a blind and baseless assertion like their own position is. Now, when I recorded the audiobook of this with David Smalley, he contested me on the first Foundational Falsehood of Creationism. There being a lot of scientists who say that, because they have their spiritual beliefs, they have their science, they accept science and all that, and so they say that because there's no evidence of God and there's no way to falsify God either, that there is nothing that science can say about God. But Smalley pointed out that there are a number of scientists, and this is why it is a false dichotomy, but Smalley pointed out that there are scientists like Victor Stengel, for example, who say that one of the things that science can say about God is that there is no support for that hypothesis. And even if you're talking to a scientist who is himself a believer, he should concede at least that much. There is also, as Stenger put it, there's no value to that hypothesis, no epistemological nor scientific value. Worse, he said that God was a meaningless concept because it is undefined and undeterminable, unfalsifiable, and unnecessary. He is literally immaterial with no reason to believe it, and I would add plenty of good reasons not to. So someone criticized me recently saying that we can't say that there's no God because we don't really know, do we? When I debated Pastor Bob Enyart at Denver Bible Church, he started into that game about how you can't prove that there's no God, and so absence of evidence doesn't mean evidence of absence and all that. And I see where he was going, so I just asked him flat out, are there leprechauns? And he said, no. He seemed very certain about that. And I said, well, have you looked everywhere? I mean, have you been to the end of the rainbow? So how can you be so certain that there's no leprechauns? And he says, because there's no evidence of them. Again, I said, well, thank you for conceding and granting me victory in this conversation. I mean, he could have said that leprechauns are impossible because of everything you know about human evolution. Of course, he was not going to say that. And leprechauns are impossible because they're magical creatures. Well, he wouldn't say that either because he wouldn't be magic himself. And he could have said that, they are impossible because everything that we know about the way the synapses fire, if you were to shrink a human down to 6 inches tall, we wouldn't be able to think that way, for these proportions, but of course he wouldn't say that either. These are the sorts of things I can say about God, that it is, among other things, it is definitively as well as physically impossible for a mind to exist independent of the brain that created it. And it is impossible for complex interdependent material systems to be conjured out of nothing by an incantation spell, speaking things into being. Believers always say that evolution somehow violates the laws of thermodynamics, even though it doesn't, and they can't explain how it would, even still, they've never read the laws of thermodynamics. But they believe that themselves, right? That God can speak anything out of nothing that he wants. He can do anything he wants. Why? Because special pleading. So all these things and more serve as my argument against God, but Enyart didn't have to go that far. If he can say that there are no leprechauns simply because there's no evidence of them, then I can say there's no God, and state it just as flatly, as factually as that, because he and I can both cite Hitchens' razor, that positive claims require positive evidence, and what is asserted without evidence can be dismissed without evidence. We don't have to investigate every star system in every galaxy far away a long time ago to prove that there was no Darth Vader. It's sufficient that there is no reason to believe there is one. We don't need to go any further than that, though I certainly can. And in addition to the dismissal of absurdities asserted without justification, I can also show positive indication that all the gods of men are creatures of the id, fabrications of the imagination. And there is no God because there cannot be a God. There is no precedent or parallel or verified phenomenon to indicate that such a thing is even possible. And miraculous gods are the silliest ideas ever conjured and commonly promoted. There is not one word of truth to it. And there still wouldn't explain anything even if it was possible. It is as empty an assertion as there can be. I'd like to take this opportunity also to address critics who said that I overstated my case when I said that the Bible is absolutely wrong about absolutely everything. I hold to that. I've said the same thing about creationists too, but you know, we have to understand that we're only talking about what's relevant to this discussion. I will accept that creationists have on occasion discovered that they were out of milk or butter, and unless they're vegan, they should go buy some more. They're welcome to be right about that. But nothing in it, none of the things that they profess to believe about evolution or of creation, none of these. I mean, we can show, and I do in my book, I'm going to show there are a number of things that we can show to be true, that we know to be true of evolution, but there's not one thing they can show to be true of creation, because there is no truth to it. Now, I will admit that some of the people and places that are mentioned in the Bible actually existed, but that doesn't lend any credence to the Bible, to none of the claims the Bible makes. There is no God, no devil, no evil spirits, no curses, no enchantments, such as the Bible describes. There is no heaven or hell, because there is no afterlife, because we have no souls. No one ever lived 3 days inside a fish. There was no army of the undead reanimated because Jehovah prayed to the four winds, which is a story very few people have read, but I thought it was one of the most fascinating books in the Bible. It's just the idea of God praying to a different God, praying to a pagan God, to have this happen. Jesus never walked on water, and may never have walked at all. Woman didn't come from a man's rib, and man didn't come from a golden spell. We know these things for absolutely certain. The tree of knowledge of good and evil was never a literal tree. It can only have been a metaphor. Everywhere where the Bible makes reference to the fruit of, everywhere other than Genesis, when it makes that reference, it's a parable. It's talking about the results of choices and so forth. So this is obviously what it meant in that parable too. Everything Jesus said was a parable, so why not Genesis? Why is Genesis the one exception where we have to take it completely literally when it cannot have been? You couldn't gather forbidden fruits and make pie out of it. Although I'd like to try it. Just imagine all the insects and birds and squirrels finding the forbidden fruit on the ground and discovering that they're naked. And we know that that story was based on elder mythology, and I go into specific descriptions of the elder mythology and how they were integrated and all of the different myths that were combined to make this one story. Experts on biblical history can't even be sure if David or Solomon ever existed, nor Jesus either. But we know there was no Adam and Eve, for certain. And, surprisingly, we can be pretty confident there was no Moses either. Goliath the giant, even if there was a David, there still wouldn't have been a Goliath. Not the way the story tells. The firmament. Anybody know what a firmament is? This was the first problem I had in reading the Bible. Trying to get, Mom, what's this? Nobody knows. But you have to read the description of the firmament is dispersed, not just in the first couple of chapters of Genesis, but all through the book. There's different references to it. What it is the Bible describes the earth as a flat disk, and it is clearly flat, not spherical. The choice of words make that clear. Now, the flat disk is divided into four quadrants, which in one place is mistranslated as corners, but it's actually quadrants. And this disc is set on pillars, so it's essentially a table. It's like a map that's on a table. And then it's covered with a giant hard crystal dome with windows in it to let the water in. Because what the snow globe world was put at the bottom of the ocean, an ocean somewhere, an eternal abyss, standing on pillars yet hung upon nothing with a dome over the top that lets water in above the firmament and fountains that come in from the bottom as well. wherein within the expanse, the concavity of this firmament, you have the sun and the moon, which are both of the same size, and they're both lights, and they're both, the moon is bigger than the stars. And in one place in the book of Daniel, three of these stars gather together to come down to the earth to do battle with a human being. Because the stars have personalities. And they're not very big. And you can, and the stars can fall down to the ground and you can stomp on them. So everything the Bible says about the earth in relation to the rest of the cosmos is completely wrong. We were never the first and the center of the entire universe. Have you noticed it takes God 4 days to construct part of the earth? Then he takes a break and sneezes out the entire cosmos. Right, and then has to take another couple of days to work on this one planet. That seems odd to me. That seems like it was written by people who didn't know that the earth wasn't a flat disk under a dome. So, a trumpet blowing down the walls of Jericho, the sun stopping in the sky, we know that none of that happened. Samson's magic hair, well, maybe that one. And someone said, well, archaeologists found the ruins of some town that was mentioned in the Bible, so that must prove the Bible true, right? Except that archaeologists also found the city of Troy, and that didn't prove anything about the gods of Hellenism. Storytellers made up their myths about the places and people that they knew about, and the same thing still happens today. In the third chapter of the Raiders of the Lost Ark series, our hero goes to Germany and accidentally, literally bumps into Adolf Hitler. Now, despite what the Holocaust deniers say, we know that Germany is real. I've been there. Hitler was real too. No relation. But that doesn't mean that Indiana Jones was real, and it doesn't mean the Ark of the Covenant was real either. Now, one thing you probably won't hear from anybody else, and I think this is my own pet hypothesis, but I want to push it out there because I think it's legitimate. There is a kernel of truth to the story of the Tower of Babel. One of the most ridiculous stories in the Bible, but think about it. The tower is real. Construction on the tower began with Hammurabi around 1750 BCE. Then the Mesopotamian Empire collapsed, construction stopped, and was picked up again by Nebuchadnezzar around 650. The tower is now, it's called the Marduk Ziggurat because it was supposed to have been dedicated to the god Marduk. Now, in the time that Hammurabi existed and begun the progress of the construction on this tower, the Mesopotamian Empire was the most advanced society on Earth. They had invented syllabic text, so they had the highest degree of writing, unprecedented, on the planet. And they had formal schools that taught children how to read and write in cuneiform, which is pressing letters of the sword into clay tablets, which would then be baked into permanent documents. But when the Mesopotamian Empire collapsed, schools closed. And within a generation, no one could read. So remember what the story was, you know, how God confused the people so that they couldn't understand anymore. Well, suddenly nobody could read cuneiform anymore. So that's, I think, the truth of that story. Importantly, though, we know that before the construction of the tower began, that there were already people in South America, in Taiwan, in Australia, and that they had already begun speaking different languages long before this tale started up. Now, importantly, though, the legends that were written by Semitic people, the grandfathers of the biblical authors, more than 1,000 years later, because these were kept alive by oral tradition, these stories were, for 1,000 years or so until the Phoenicians eventually wrote them down again. Then, in relatively recent history, we discovered Dr. Burnable's library for a number of these cuneiform documents written around 2200 BCE and earlier, the most recent ones being around 2200. And we realize that all these stories from these ancient Semitic people have important elements that, not the main element, I mean, it was never the God, you know, the Christian God or the Jewish God, it was not the central figure. But important details in many of these different legends are perilously similar to another story we know. Like the story of Enki trespassing on the sacred garden and eating of all of the fruit that was forbidden to him. Not just one, all of the fruit was forbidden, so he ate them all. And then he was caught by Ninhursag, the goddess, who cursed him, and he fell. And then she felt bad about it, so she bore 7 daughters to cure the wounds, to cure his wounds. And one of them was Ninti, the daughter born of the rib, for she was born to close the wound to his side. I thought, gosh, gosh, that sounds familiar. So this is how we see how these elements are adapted and blended together and made to accommodate a new theology, right? So what was originally dedicated to Marduk has now been reappropriated to another god that was promoted out of the Canaanite pantheon. Hammurabi's code, the Stela of Law, actually exists. It's on display at the Louvre. But the Ark of the Covenant, which was based on that, and even copied lines from it, apparently only exists in movies. Moses was supposed, and we also know that Moses was supposed to have been several centuries after Hammurabi, so we know which story is the remake. Moses was supposed to have parted the Red Sea a millennium after one of the Egyptian pharaohs had already done the same thing, only that a thousand years before the time attributed to Moses, commonly attributed to Moses. Nobody could really figure out when Moses was supposed to live because he doesn't fit anywhere, and that's another problem with him. The story about Moses doesn't even appear until about 250 BC, so nobody knows Moses prior to that. But we know Sargon, which had the same childhood as Moses, in verbatim in places. So you have the story where the Pharaoh Snefru, I forget how long ago this was, 2200 something, the Pharaoh Snefru takes his barge out on the lake. It's one of his, he's a head of state, so he goes out for lake vacations like so many leaders do. And his method of vacationing and taking the pressures off was to strip down a bunch of buxom young girls and put them each on his oars to row his boat while he sits and watches them row. Good be the king. And one of these girls dropped a turquoise bottle over the side of the boat and became so upset about it that he called over his mage, Jajamank, and the mage cast a spell over the lake so that they could lift up the lake and fold it over onto itself like a blanket to pull up this turquoise bottle and get it back to the slave maiden. I'm pretty sure that for this thousands of years, or a thousand years or so, that people were telling the story that nobody actually thought that really happened, right? I'm pretty sure that most people just thought that was a story. And it really kind of ruins Cecil B. DeMille's idea of the parting of the Red Sea, because there was a better story that pre-existed that in the same place already. And it always struck me as, why would God create anything that was a sequel to a human idea, especially when he didn't do it as well, right? I mean, I ran